Good morning. A warm welcome to all the panelists, students, and guests. Thank you for taking time out to attend the Best Spoke Show. Best Spoke is defined as something that is custom-made. The Best Spoke Show is an initiative conceptualized to live up to the dictionary definition. It is neither another Me Too inspirational talk, nor it is a platform to share larger than personal life stories. TBS is a forum for candid discussion on topics interesting, covering conventional and non-conventional sectors, mainstreams, and careers, art and literature, media, entertainment, and even international affairs. Ms. Asha Sampat and Mr. Sid Baliga jointly host the Best Spoke Shows. May I request Ms. Asha and Mr. Sid to take seats on the dais. Today's discussion is on the unaccidental entrepreneur, wherein we hear three perspectives from three seasoned leaders who have years of expertise in entrepreneurship ecosystem. We have with us three panelists. It's my privilege to invite Mr. Aakarsh Naidu, founder, CEO, Startupreneur. Sir, may I request you to occupy a seat on the dais. Mr. Aakarsh is an alumnus of London School of Economics and is a former research associate, ISB, Hyderabad, and former startup ecosystem engagement lead at NSRCL, IIM, Bangalore. Mr. Aakarsh has presented on platforms such as Asia Pacific Week, Niti Aayog, NASCOM, IIMB, ZIMB, IEEE, Startup Asia Berlin, British Council, Total Group, and Bosch, to name a few. He has been covered in Financial Times, International Finance, Business Because, Les Eco France, Bangalore Mirror, Times of India, Hindu Business Line, Silicon India, and Berlin Senate's newsletter. We welcome you, sir. Now, it's my pleasure to call upon Mr. Amarinder Singh, Chief Involvement Officer, CIO, Association of India. Sir, I request you to take a seat on the dais. Mr. Amarinder Singh, alumnus of Delhi Institute of Technology and FMS, Delhi University. Specialties: starting initiatives grounds up, nurturing engagements to next scale, fast learner, ability to wear many hats, and getting it all wrong at times. I request our HOD Professor Nikita to welcome Mr. Amarinder Singh. Yeah. I request our Dean, Dr. Veena, to welcome Mr. Aakarsh Naidu. Mr. Vijetha Shastry is the Executive Director, Thai Bangalore, and our next panelist for today. And I request you to take a seat on the dais. Mr. Vijetha Shastry, possessing 25 years handling challenging assignments in the service industry, hospitality, retail, travel, co-working. Recent assignment was with NASCOM COE as Lead Open Innovation. I request Professor Meera Sheshana to welcome Mr. Vijetha Shastry. Welcome you, sir. May I now request Ms. Asha and Mr. Sid Baliga to lead the show and give the audience insights into making of the unaccidental entrepreneur.
Thank you. Good morning to the panelists and thank you all. Thank you students for coming over. The topic is already displayed on the screen. Before we get on to the discussion, I would like to ask the students, how many of you would like to become entrepreneurs? Please raise your hands. How many of you would like to become entrepreneurs? Please raise your hands. Okay. Anybody else? How many of you don't want to become entrepreneurs? How many are undecided? Okay. So there are a few people who are undecided also. So right. So the first question was, how many of you want to become entrepreneurs? And we have seen some people have very clear thought process on becoming entrepreneurs in future. Right, that sets the context for the discussion for today. About 30 to 40 years back, there was nothing called planned entrepreneurship. People became entrepreneurs either out of compulsion, forced entrepreneurship, or by accident. Some situations in life, some ideas, something happened, and they became businessmen, or started off some venture. Or they could not find employment opportunities, they turned to some kind of trade, some kind of business, and they became entrepreneurs. So that was forced entrepreneurship during those days. But now, of late in last decade or two, we have seen incubation cells and accelerators and so many other e-cells in colleges trying to help budding entrepreneurs, aspiring entrepreneurs, chase their dreams and startup ventures, right? So now, and in the panel, we have Mr. Aakarsh Naidu, who has been closely associated with the NSRCL IMB incubation system. And I think no other person to better person to start off with. So Aakarsh, I want to know basically what is the use of having these incubation cells, e-cells? Do they mitigate the risk, reduce the risks of failure among structured entrepreneurship or planned entrepreneurship? Aakarsh, you can start off.
Ideal from a camera perspective.
Thank you very much for this event, so to start with, since I was associated with IIM Bangalore's incubator, first of all, you need to understand what a startup incubator really does. It's nothing but an organization which supports other startups, and an incubator is also like another startup. So it's a startup which is supporting other startups, and incubators work with entrepreneurs right from the idea stage, so they help nurture the idea and take it to the next level. It could mean giving some guidance around the business model or validating the concept with potential customers. Hello? And even seed funding and infrastructure that is required. So this is like this initial support that is given to entrepreneurs through something called as a startup incubator. Now coming to how effective they are, being part of an incubator myself, I would still say it depends. The reason being that there have been many successful entrepreneurs who have done really well even without being part of incubators. In fact, most of them are entrepreneurs who've set out on their own. However, I feel that incubators do play a role for a certain segment of entrepreneurs. These are especially entrepreneurs who have an idea but need an external structure around them to take it to the next level. And these are the people who are open to taking inputs, because an incubator program is heavily dependent on mentoring, and how you receive the inputs from the mentors and translate that into your venture becomes really important. So you need to be mentorable and a person who could leverage from an incubation setup. So and then there is a third category of entrepreneurs who are neither motivated nor a structure can help them. So they're better off doing something else. I mean, I'm not saying this in a negative sense, but it's always better to understand the abilities and act accordingly. Yeah, so thanks.
So Vijetha, would you like to add on to this point of entrepreneurship getting incubated in e-cells or incubators? Do you think, let's say,
people who have not had the opportunity to go through these e-cells, let's say in the past, compared to now, we have got more people going through these e-cells and taught programs in entrepreneurship. Yeah. So do you think they have a better chance of being successful now?
Sure. So I think one of the things that we must acknowledge is that in the incubators and accelerators, you get to meet a lot of very good quality people. Right? You get the mentorships, you get the exposure. So if I may just ask the students out here, how many of you have actually attended a demo day? Have you all gone for any demo day by any accelerator? Have you all ever visited IMB? Have you all ever visited NSR Cell, NASCOM? Yes, no? So then, you know, it will be very strange if we give an input when they don't have the real ground level understanding. But since we're having this conversation, I would one thing that I would really like to say is that in the Bangalore ecosystem specifically, all the entrepreneurs and the startup founders are extremely lucky.
Lucky.
They're very lucky because the kind of opportunities that you will get, because you have Cisco, you have SAP, you have Intel, you have NASCOM, which incubates like, you know, 150, 200 startups per year. So these kind of opportunities are something that really helps the entrepreneur. Because what is the meaning of incubation or acceleration or getting exposed, right? You want to meet mentors, which Aakarsh very clearly said. But then being ready to listen to the mentor and take out the nuggets of wisdom is a behavioral and mindset skill. Can that be taught? I don't know. Okay, I would not like to comment on that. Okay, number one. Number two is ultimately, any of you guys, right, if you all start a startup or a business, you all, some of you, I understand that some of you are from business families. Yes, some of you actually have a first generation or second generation business family. A few of you are that, right? Is it easy? You have seen your families maybe struggle at times, you know, like getting business, getting payments and all that. So it's not easy. Okay, it is not glamorous to become an entrepreneur. So a support of an incubator is that they can help you to get customers. They can help you get exposed to customers. They can help you to expose to processes. The reason why you know, the privilege that they have of being in a fantastic institute like the Dayanand Sagar Institute is they get to understand about legal, the financial part of it, the business acumen part of it, right? But the world is very tough at times. India at times is not so very good in making payments on time. Right, so what do you do with that? Can an accelerator or an incubator or a college teach you those kind of skills? Maybe not. But having said that, I mean, Aakarsh is being a little bit modest about NSR Cell. They do make a big difference, but not immediately. It takes time. Because only when you get your skills and you start facing the real world and you face disappointments, you face not very good, pleasant experiences, you meet the people who are not the nicest of people in the world, that's when you think back to the skill sets that you gained during the incubation process, you remember the lessons learned, you remember the interactions with seasoned entrepreneurs who have been successes and failures, and that's where you really grow. So yes, it is important to get yourselves into an incubator or accelerator for a certain period of time, because it helps a lot. But there is always a price to pay. Sometimes when you get into an incubator or accelerator, you have to give away a little bit of your IP, you have to give away a little bit of your equity into your company. Now, are you willing to pay that price? Is it worth it? Again, that's a decision that you have to very, very carefully, whether a single co-founder or if you have a team, you have to think through that and go. But take advantage of what Bangalore has to offer. Fantastic ecosystem. You know, entrepreneurs get a lot of value. So it will be foolish to ignore the privileges that you can get, but at the same time, a decision has to be taken whether it is, you know, where is the right fitment. I hope that answers the question, sir. Thank you.
Interesting perspective about whether incubator.
No, I just wanted to say that if startup ecosystem was a person, then that would be Vijetha. He speaks ecosystem and is really one of the most connected people here. So of course you can reach out to him if you are perhaps at an advanced stage of your idea. Not waste his time, but you know, happy.
We are taking this point forward about the behavioral aspect of being open to mentorship and taking advantage of the ecosystem. Does it have a relation with the demography? For example, if somebody is starting a startup at, let's say, 25 years of age, they don't have too much to unlearn, right? So it's easy for them to take advantage of the ecosystem and do things the right way. But if somebody is starting an entrepreneurship journey, let's say at 45, there's a mindset issue that comes in the way, and there'll also be a lot of baggage that they carry in terms of the one particular way of doing things. So they may not be very open to incubator advantages. So Amarinder, I just want to know, do you see a success rate advantage or a disadvantage either way, the ones who start off early on their entrepreneurship journey versus people who have worked on corporates and then come to face an entrepreneurial challenge?
You're saying the success rate?
Yep.
Okay. First of all, thank you so much for having me here. The people who wanted to start, who wanted to become entrepreneurs, I thought they would be sitting in the front. So, you know, if you really want to start, you have to take each and every initiative, each and every opportunity. You don't sit at the back and raise your hand, okay. Asha has asked me a very interesting question. To be honest, I do not have a very satisfying answer. I'm sure there are a lot of surveys being done. In fact, there are some survey reports available in the public domain, which will give you statistics on how many entrepreneurs are successful if they start early or if they start late. However, I can share just a couple of things from my perspective, especially when she mentioned about being open and being, you know, at the age of 25, you know, you are a little more open, and at the age of 40, 45, you are a little more closed. So let's just put things in perspective here. It depends. Suppose if you are doing a very domain-specific startup, then I think if you start at the age of 40 or so, you have the advantage of knowing a domain. Okay. So, for example, you worked in a pharma or a healthcare, or you worked in insurance, and you worked there for 10, 12 years. You worked in a strategy, or you worked in a McKinsey or somewhere. You have got some domain expertise. If you are building a startup on that domain expertise or understanding that industry, you know, then that is definitely an advantageous, right? So, first of all, you have to understand that when it comes to startups and when it comes to life, there is no right answer. What works for you will not work for somebody else. It always happens. So let's take an example. It's a proven fact that people who are not part of that industry look at disrupting that industry in ways in which people who were part of the industry never thought. If you are part of an industry, you tend to believe the what everybody else believes in. Like example of Tesla, right? Elon Musk, right? He comes and changes an automotive industry, or Steve Jobs comes and changes the music industry. They were not part of that industry. They looked at it in a completely different way, and they could disrupt. So you can say, fine, then not having a domain knowledge actually worked for them in a way. But what happened, they worked on first principle basis. One thing which you should learn in your college right now is what are first principles, how to work on something using first principles from a very fundamental perspective. In fact, my colleague here would be knowing Sharad Sharma. He always talks about building things using first principles. So that's very important. I have a neighbor who built things using first principles, okay? So now, if you look at these examples of Elon Musk or Steve Jobs, they disrupted industries which they were not part of. On the other hand, I'm sure, you know, when all of us meet VCs and they are meeting people who are doing domain-based startup, they would prefer to maybe back those guys who have got 10, 12 years of experience, because they know the industry out, they know the processes, they know where the inefficiencies, they know what are the challenges, not only technical, functional, but cultural, right? But then there are contrasts. Now look at it. Banks are feeling threatened by fintech. You know, bank CXOs have a tough time, you know. Three bunch of 20 years old is taking away market from a bank. Now, the bank guys knew everything, right? They knew everything. They had, but how come the three youngsters are taking it away from them, right? So both things work. So domain expertise also works. Looking completely different on something works. Now, being in terms of openness, right? See, you have to identify a good mentor. One thing which I've seen in India, and as he rightly said, at least in Bangalore, people have been very, very helpful. Relatively very, very helpful, okay? In fact, even Steve Jobs had an example when he picked up a phone directory and called somebody, I don't know, some company CEO, and he picked up and he helped him. Others didn't. Sometimes you don't ask for help, but if you ask for help, help is available. So I've seen, at least within the startup community, the other CIO community which I run, people are generally helpful if you reach out. It depends how you reach out. Your mannerism, how specific you are, people are generally helpful. Now, how to identify a good mentor and how does the chemistry works? That is definitely important. I would like to just share one thing, and I think both my colleagues here might, I don't know how they will take my line, but many years ago, when it comes to startup ecosystem, we didn't have anything. Today we have a lot, we have a lot. Now if you start comparing it with US or Israel or China, you can always compare and you can always say, oh, we don't have enough. That would always be the case. But at the same time, we also have a lot of noise. You have to also figure out that while we have more than what 10 years ago, when we started Open Coffee Club, one of India's oldest startup community, we have come a long way. But we also have a lot of noise. So you have to identify that whom do I go to. A lot of people may claim to be a mentor, claim to be an advisor, but they may not be. So you have to be thorough. If you are thorough, then you are able to see, the person on the other side, is really adding value, right? So there is no escape from you doing your homework. There is no. All the facilities which they are talking about, the incubators, they will all help if you take the first step. If you don't take the first step, nobody can this thing. In terms of numbers, I'm sorry, I don't have. So, but I'm sure there are reports at a global level and at this level. But yeah, if you're doing a domain startup, I think having some experience would definitely help. Yeah.
Amarinder, maybe I just want to add, because I have some experience, direct experience in this to this question. A basic point is, I feel entrepreneurship cannot be taught, but it can certainly be learnt. The way I approach this is, there are certain concepts that that this is how entrepreneurship is done, but only when you get on the field and try it out is when you actually learn and you can keep improving. So there is no particular type of entrepreneur that exists, or this only people of a certain trait can become entrepreneurs. It's your core that will define what kind of entrepreneur you become. Pretty much certain founders are very charismatic, and for example, Elon Musk as a brand is bigger than Tesla itself. So that is one way of looking at it. And then there is Vijay Shekhar Sharma, where the brand is bigger than the person that he projects. So it's all about your personal and other aspects can be very different, and anybody can become an entrepreneur. That's a starting point. And in terms of timing, you would internally feel when it's like the right time, because I was part of an incubator. I used to see hundreds of startups who are working with me. I'm working directly with them, helping them out. But I didn't have the urge to jump into entrepreneurship then. But after a point, I was kind of working for a few years. I even had an offer from Facebook to join it. But I could not pursue it, because at that point I felt the need to get into entrepreneurship. So I took the call. All I can say is, having a few years of experience in some domain actually helps when it comes to running your own venture, because there is a certain level of maturity and experience that you gain, which is definitely helpful while you're doing the venture. We've seen success stories of people who just went right from college and experimented and became big and all of that. Yeah, thanks.
Sure. So I'm just taking two points from the Akash's points and from Amarinder's points. One, Amarinder mentioned about large banks, and you mentioned about fintech firms, smaller fintech firms, which are disrupting the space. And Akash mentioned a point about entrepreneurship cannot be taught, but it has to be learned, right? So now, obviously, entrepreneurship is more inherent rather than making somebody get excited about some project. So if I am excited about some idea, I would stay awake all night and try to work on it. And I don't get this taught at some college. But yet we see a lot of colleges having PG programs in entrepreneurship, PG programs in family businesses, PG programs in a lot of things around this entrepreneurship ecosystem. So obviously the fintech firm, the example that you gave, the disruption is possible because they had a burning desire to do something in the finance space and they are able to take on much larger players in that space. Now looking at this from a venture capital or an investor perspective, okay, so how would a VC or an investor look at two options? On one hand, there is a guy who has studied from IIT, IIM, gone through a structured entrepreneurship program, got incubated in NSRCL or some other ecosystem. Vis-a-vis a guy who is not from an IIT, IIM, did not go through all these mentorship and ecosystem, but yet has a good idea. So how does the investor look at it? So anyone can pick this up.
Can I answer? Yeah, sure. Okay. To the broader point, I think I would draw upon what Amarinder said, that it has to be driven in terms of, what you really want to do with your venture. Then the support can really help. Otherwise, it doesn't. So in terms of, IIT, IA, a factor of the your revenues, which means if you're making maybe 50 lakhs of business, then your valuation would be 5 to 10 times of that approximately, which means 3 to 5 CR would be like your valuation. Therefore, you need to remember that if you have a solid business with paying customers, investors are willing to look at you and speak to you. That's the first thing. The second thing is, investors usually look for the vision. I interact with a few investors myself who are like mentors to my venture. So I went ahead and started pitching my products to them. This is what we built and all of that. But the investor asked me to just hold on and said, forget all this. Tell me within 3 years where you see this company going. I want the big picture vision. I don't care about the smaller details. Let your vision be big and you chase that. That's all I care about. I'm not looking at any other aspects. So if you are, as a founder, showcasing that kind of a vision and big picture thinking, investors are willing to look at it. Where IITs and IIMs are usually helpful are in terms of networks. So the way it works is mostly graduates of IITs and IIMs are, they work as associates or analysts at these various venture capital firms. So these are the people who are often looking out for startups which are, shared with the investors. So if you are like an IIT, IIM, it's almost like, reaching out to another friend or a senior from your college and telling that I have a startup idea, and it's like more likely to be pushed. So it's only that you get an initial advantage, but then in terms of the final funding, it depends on your real worth of the idea and how you're executing. This is also like, the star kids, in Bollywood and wherever else, like, they just get like that initial breakthrough. Like, so for example, Abhishek Bachchan, he's Amitabh Bachchan's son, and then he had all things going for him. That's in some sense like an IIT and IIM kind of a lineage, but he hasn't made it as an actor, but of course he's doing other things. But the point is, being from IIT, IIM will give you that initial breakthrough, but it doesn't guarantee success. And it all depends on how you really drive the conversation with the investors.
So if I could just, and since we are on camera, I'll just give you how it really works. So it's not just about the VCs alone, so what happens here is, and this is a very interesting perspective I've been getting from very solid people who are influencers, but they're also investors. So what they say is, like, the real money comes from the sovereign wealth funds, okay? For example, it will come from, say, Bahrain or Saudi Arabia and Norway, whatever. And how are they making their money? They're making their money from oil, gas, energy, which is the old school of making wealth, right? Now, they will decide, the pension funds, and I know that the pension funds are huge. The US and Canada pension funds run into hundreds of billions of dollars. So they will say that, okay, we trust Sequoia. We trust Matrix, we trust Excel. And then they say, okay, these are the themes that you want, you want to invest in. It could be fintech. It definitely could be, healthcare. It could be something like think of the money that has been invested in Uber and WeWork. It runs into billions of dollars. Has there been any return on it? Not really. right? We are in this beautiful country called India. We have so much of problems with water and whatever. I mean, you can go on and on, agri-tech problems, all that. How much money is getting pumped into that? Negligible, right? There are subsidies, there is government support, but there is no big money that is being put into solving these problems. Okay, it is being put into solving a Swiggy and Zomato. How many of you guys use Swiggy and Zomato? Convenient? Is it convenient? Yeah? You also realize that you are generating a lot of waste. No, you don't generate any waste?
No, I didn't realize.
Yeah, you don't realize, right? But that is the waste that you're generating, which is going into the soil, and that's when you guys are much younger, right? I'm going to conk off before you, right? Now, that is the water, that is the whatever fruits and vegetables that you guys are going to eat as you grow, and it's going to get tougher and tougher. Okay, so just think about this, right? And that is a real tragedy about the so-called investment scenario right now. But can you blame the investor? Not at all. Why? Because it's so simple. It's all about return on investment. There's no returns on investing in some of these kind of projects. That is today's scenario. Things are changing, right? A lot of people are saying now we have to talk about sustainability. We have to talk about waste management. We have to talk about, you know, air. We have to talk about water. Huge money is going to be pumped into that. Are you guys technology guys or you all are MBA students? Non-technology, right? So my simple word of advice to you is learn technology. Because I will tell you something about Elon Musk and all these other great guys, right? We only see the headlines. Okay, when we talk about Virat Kohli or Sachin Tendulkar, you all relate to them? Right? You can relate to, you know, some of, I wish I could give some more examples, but do you think that when they come out and they play, they just play for that half day, one day, 25, 30 times a year, right? Or you look at, Serena Williams, the Williams sisters, they've been playing for 20 years. Then you look at some of, the shuttlers, PV Sindhu and Sania Mirza, and also the women leaders, Kiran Mazumdar, Shaw, etc., etc. They have worked very hard behind the scenes to understand technology, understand business. They have slogged on weekends, hundreds of hours, going out into the market, talking to future customers. They have had doors slammed on their face. Okay? A lot of people, Aakarsh, we have met so many successful entrepreneurs who have grown over 5 years, 10 years, because we know them from, so many years. We have been part of their, failures and success stories. They work very, very hard. So the investors will also look at the team. Okay, it's not just a team, it's about the team, the founder, the power, the selling skills or the convincing skills that the founder has to say that me and my team are someone that you should back. Because we understand the market, we understand customers, we understand that if something is going wrong, we can pivot. We don't pivot because it's fashionable to pivot, but we pivot because we know that the world is moving towards that. Alright, so definitely VCs, I will just summarize this. Sovereign funds, government, because grants also can be seen as investments. What do the huge the people like Sequoias and the Matrix, the lead investors, will then disseminate it down to the ground? We should also never ignore the very massive fact that there are angels, angel investors. You guys understand what is angel investors? If you are taking some notes, there's Indian Angel Network, Mumbai Angels, Chennai Angels. Just go to their, search these things, guys, on Google. Look at the portfolio companies that they're investing in. They're also investing in a lot of consumerism kind of products. They're investing in a lot of fintech, clean tech, etc., etc., right? So there's a lot of work happening on niches also. So, like if you see Rajan Anand of ex-Google, and now he's with Sequoia, right? He has invested in some, 30 or 40 companies. Find out what is the companies that he has invested in. Then you look at some of the really marquee, well-known angels, like what the Ola Cab founders are doing, what are the Taxi for Sure founders doing, where are they putting their money? They're putting a small money. But because they're putting money, so many people have followed them. A classic example would be what Ratan Tata has done, right? He has invested in Your Story. He has invested, in some of these jewelry companies, etc., etc., right? So that kind of gives a perspective that if such senior people are putting in their time, effort, mentoring, and money into a company, that sector is going to be something that should be paid attention to. So there are various perspectives as to how angels and how VCs and how governments will invest and put their money in or give grants. So if there were biotech students here, I would have said, look at BIRAC. Fantastic organization, really, really good organization, right? So this is a crisp, I can keep talking, which is not fair, but happy to share more notes later. Thank you.
question.
Yeah, next. Okay. I was just thinking about, we were talking about incubators and accelerators. Is that a recent trend in India? It's been existing in the West much longer than in India, right? But looking at some statistics from NASSCOM, China startups would achieve the much hyped unicorn status in 4 to 5 years, whereas Indian companies are achieving that in 5 to 7 years, and US takes 7 to 8 years. So even without the support of accelerators and incubators, how have we been able to be claiming second position there is something that intrigues me. Any thoughts?
So I want to answer this question primarily because I belong to that ecosystem of working with incubators, accelerators, maybe investors to some extent. So, you know, the concept of incubation and acceleration is seen very differently in India and the Western world. In the Silicon Valley or the US, acceleration comes before incubation. Basically, it is at an idea stage that, you know, an entrepreneur engages in an accelerator program and then comes to a point where it is ready for further support. That's when incubation happens. In India, the concept is different. So in India, when you're at an idea stage is when you come for incubation, and then once you have the first 10 paying customers is when you are ready to go for acceleration. So keeping these two in mind, so there's another category which has evolved in the last 1-2 years, which is called pre-incubation. So that is like more of a very, very early stage, first step that an institution takes in nurturing entrepreneurs. So this is like you're at an intent stage. I have an idea, I'm thinking of entrepreneurship. This is what my idea looks like. Can I test it out? If it fails, I don't want to do it. If it works, I want to do it. That's the space that, you know, institutions are helping out, and some people are realizing that whether entrepreneurship is for them or not, even through that kind of process. So that is something that has evolved, and our understanding as an ecosystem, in terms of what is a startup, what are the, you know, successes, failures, what it means, all of that has evolved quite a lot in the last 3 to 5 years. And the funding scenario also changed, evolved along with that. Earlier, investors used to put their money in very early stage startups. Now they're putting their money in late stage ventures, which is their ticket size has increased. So if they were investing 50 million in 50 startups earlier, now they're investing 50 million in 5 startups. So they're investing 10 million in each of the startups. So what this does is it takes a startup from, say, you know, $100 million valuation to a unicorn status, which is $1 billion valuation, in much shorter time. And with money coming in from Japan and China, like, you know, Japan through SoftBank, a lot of money has come in, and therefore being invested in OYO, Ola, and all those ventures. And similarly, Alibaba is also putting a lot of money into Paytm. So this kind of money flowing in actually is helping a lot of the successful startups, go to the next unicorn level. So the growth has been right from 1 to 100, like, you know, right from an idea stage to a late stage venture. There are different bodies which have evolved, and they're supporting entrepreneurs across the entire spectrum. Yeah.
So it's more the investors bringing in money that's bringing them to the unicorn status.
Yes, it's helping them scale faster. Like you spoke about the number of years, right?
Right.
That has significantly come down only because a lot more money is going in,
right,
into late stage ventures.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I'll give a perspective about this, and, you know, again, please do take these notes on this. So if you study certain specific accelerators that are working in India, correct? You have Target, you have Cisco, you have SAP, you have Bosch, then you have Intel plugin. So these are about 5 of the big guys, right? So they have started this in the last few years, and now we see very specifically where do they stand vis-a-vis the companies that they have incubated or accelerated or part of the cohort. So what they have been doing is they have been actually taking these companies. One is they walk the talk. Now, what I mean by walk the talk is, like, for example, a Target would say that, okay, you 5 guys are part of our cohort, and we're giving you business. We'll be your customers, right? So now these are multi-billion dollar organizations. For them to give, you know, even like, say, $50,000 or $100,000 on a global, you know, like a use case or a global POC to solve or some business to be given to them, that's a massive boost, because the due diligence would be very, very tough, correct? there is no compromise. Just because you happen to be a cohort startup of these accelerators is giving you no special privilege. Ultimately, you're a vendor. Right? That's it. You're a vendor. You have to pass through the processes, the due diligence, but you've got the business. It'll be made easy for you because they'll help you to reach that level of competence. And then people trust you. Right? Other people will come up and say, okay, if you've done work for Target or you're doing work for Bosch, damn good. Then you look at companies like what SAP does. Okay, they take these, SAP doesn't have this own manufacturing or retail, whatever it is, right? But what they do is, they will take these companies and jointly they will take the product, which is verified by SAP, and then go to global customers, right? Again, the ticket size will be like, you know, 100,000, 200,000 US dollars. That's massive. The moment you start getting that, you start getting, your company gets evaluated at a multi-million dollar evaluation. People will start investing in you. People will start giving you more and more business. I think, and then real important impact is more employees will be created. A lot of the co-founders will start, you know, when you've got some money, you'll put in some money into other startups. You'll become mentors for other startups. So I'll be very blunt. I use that methodology, right? I talk to these founders and I tell them, take workshops for us, right? Talk to other 25, 30 aspiring founders. Come to say, you know, Dayanand Sagar College and explain how it really works. They won't listen so much to us, but they listen to these guys. Because they've been there, done that, struggled, failed, messed up, etc., etc., but now they're super successful. So accelerators and incubators are playing that role now. So if you see what NetApp is doing also, they're fantastic companies, okay, who are working on big data and artificial intelligence, right? They're actually taking them to more and more global customers. They're creating these speed meetings where, you know, at least 25, 30 other investors, about 15 other corporates are coming and talking to these guys and giving them business. Talking to them and giving them term sheets. And these term sheets are worth $1 million, $2 million, $5 million, not small. Okay? Another organization that you all should also look up is Idea Spring Capital. So one of their key people is a CTO. Okay? In the investor investment portfolio, they actually have someone who's a chief technology officer who actually understands technology. So he will evaluate, he will do the diagnosis. He's a very good, he's a charter member, of course, of TAI. And he will also do a diagnostic of the technology. And you can't, I mean, look, he's done 3 exits. He's been part of 5 startups. I mean, you don't lie to him, right? I mean, because he understands technology like the back of his hand. So things are changing. So in the initial stages, it was the McKinsey's of the world who are part of the, of course, people from London School of Economics also, I think, are involved. But now you have people from the entrepreneur world are coming in. There are people who are hardcore technologists who are joining investment companies because they can really evaluate. So the sum total of what the learning in this is that incubators, accelerators also are evolving. Okay. It's not, they're also evolving, okay. Right? They're not just doing this for the sake of doing this. They're actually walking the talk by giving business. They're giving investments. They're giving grants. They're giving technology. Yeah. They're giving data. Right? So for one of the biggest thing is, like say here you have all the students. You have, you know, you have all your technical students, etc. They need something to work on. They need a prototype. They need a business use case. They need something that they can show that, okay, if I build this, this is my solution, but it's already solving a predefined problem. Now, unless you have that, you really can't grow. But the accelerators and incubators with their business units are doing this really evolved, fantastic work. But are we anywhere close to an Israel, China, whatever? Maybe not. Okay, but you know what? Let's not go into that game ever. We're not competing. It should be the other way around. Get the best people from Israel and China and Japan and Korea, Germany, Estonia, of all places, Singapore. Get them here. Let there be a cross-border kind of cultural exchange. Figure out the IP, figure out the, how it works, what is the paperwork, documentation, whatever. Because that is what is going to create an impact, employment. You know, I will keep talking about that. Ultimately, it's about jobs. Right? 2,500 students, right, ma'am, who are part of your campus. How many pass out every year? 500 students, right? So there should be 500 jobs waiting. Entrepreneurship can create maybe 20%. Honestly, 20%, that's the max. You still need jobs. Okay? So what do you do? No answers, but let's think about that. Okay? Thank you.
Just in continuation, we often hear this, that investors don't fund ideas, they fund products and teams. But for innovative ideas to get converted into viable products that the market wants, there are a lot of things that go into it, right? It's besides the idea itself, it's the technology, it's the design thinking, it's the funding, it's the go-to-market, it's the patent protection. So to what extent can startups fall back on incubators and accelerators for all of these support systems?
Okay. Looks like I'm a little odd one out here, because I think all your questions are around. I haven't myself gone with an idea to an incubator accelerator. I, if you don't mind, if you allow me the liberty, I'll go a little bit back on the topic, because I had some little different thoughts, and I think my colleagues have spoken a lot about some incubators, accelerators, and valuations and investors. But I feel your journey is there is some distance between that, right? So let's talk a little bit about your initial journey, and I'll see if I can try and answer that question from this. So, and I want to talk about from my own personal experience, because that's where I have full faith on. I can't talk from other people's experience, right? So, 2008, I came to Bangalore by chance. I got involved in the startup ecosystem by chance. It was not planned. It was completely by chance. And, for me, startups was a new phenomena, right? So we had, when I say startups, I'm talking about first generation entrepreneurs whose parents are not entrepreneurs, and who essentially do not have much capital in their home or network or not much know-how, right? Somebody from a typical average middle class, with due respect, says, hey, I want to start a company, and you know, everybody's not very comfortable, right? And those people go and start, right? Now that seemed a very, very new phenomena to me. And it's only recently I've realized that let's get down at what at the bottom of it. See, essentially in this whole discussion, we are trying to figure out what you can do on your own and what help is available. When you go out and you have accelerator, incubator, ecosystem, you have Head Start, you have the Beak Spoke Show, and you have all of them, you know, they help you bridge the gap, right? So let's start at a very fundamental level. What I realized that what I was thinking though to be a new phenomenon is actually not new. It's something you go a little more deeper on a psychology level. A sportsman trying to excel, an artist trying to produce his or her masterclass, a king in olden times trying to win a battle, an army general trying to win a war, you trying to build a startup, there is absolutely no difference. There is difference of semantics and context, but if you see, essentially all of you are trying to do something bigger, you have a vision, you have a constraint. See, when you talk of startup, the first thing is about constraint. Don't think of abundance. Constraint is the first important thing. I am a student, how can I build a Swiggy? How can I build a Flipkart, right? I'm just a student, I'm just an engineering student, right? First thing is the constraint, right? So, first of all, what I felt that, and I'm a very poor student of history, and I learn more, I would encourage all of you to read more and more about history. A lot of things which we are facing today, I think people, generations before have faced the same challenges. It's just that, there in our world was different. So essentially what it starts is that, see, what I want you to understand is this, that on the topic, right, unplanned entrepreneur, like, it is not, you know, a lot of you raised your hands, right, that we want to be an entrepreneur. See, you have to understand that it's a conviction game. It is not a mathematics game. You cannot become an entrepreneur using a PPT and an Excel, I'm sorry. It has to be a conviction game. Conviction cannot come. Conviction cannot be taught. Conviction cannot be imparted. Conviction cannot come. Let's look. We talk about Ola. The founder was on a cab, and the cab stopped, and the cab guy didn't behave. I don't know the story, but he felt there should be a better way. Right? He felt. Everybody felt there should be a better way. So, Paul Graham says that you really can't do a good job if you're not thinking about it while taking a shower, right? So, see, startup is like a love affair. You can't plan it. It happens,
Okay, you can say I have a desire to be an entrepreneur. It can remain for 20 years, but which thing you will jump on? Now, if I look at my career, and the latest thing which I'm interested in is something which I never thought of. I'm a little bit interested in the legal industry, where I have no connection, I have no upbringing, I have no formal knowledge, but something happened in my life which got me a little bit interaction with the legal people. And I'm like, oh my God, this is like so inefficient. This is like, so many people lose so much of their money, time, and life fighting these things, which should be like a much better way. Now, because I personally going through a legal problem, so I'm realizing it. So though I'm an engineer, MBA, I worked in different industries, but somehow legal is exciting me a little bit more now because it's very personal. So first it has to come out of conviction. So you can't force it, okay? So when you talk about what help is available about, from your incubators or accelerators, right? So first thing is this, that it is about conviction. So no investor will invest in you until you do not have the conviction. So first is the conviction, right? After conviction, we come to a point which is very important, and in recent times, I haven't had much interaction with VCs, but those whom I really admire, it's about leverage. Within your given constraints, what leverage you are building vis-a-vis others, right? What leverage are you building vis-a-vis your others within your given constraints, which is giving you an advantage? So, thankfully, I have one data point to share with you, is that a lot of millennials do not trust their banks. They do not trust banks and insurance company. Now, I'm a GoDigit customer. You go and check about this insurance company, GoDigit. It is trying to make insurance very easy for you to understand. What is the policy? What are you buying? What are you covered? It is making it very friendly. The whole process, though I've had a bad experience with them, and I will go and fight with them on that. But as compared to a lot of other insurance policy companies, their whole process of engaging a customer, onboarding a customer, and servicing a customer, and renewing a customer is different. Now, what are they doing, right? So now they are not in a race. When it comes to Zomato and Swiggy or a Flipkart on Amazon, there is a daily race, right? You cannot sleep because you don't know tomorrow what your competition is launching. You know, they launch 3-day delivery, 24-hour delivery, then they're launching, same 1-week delivery, then the same day delivery, then within 2 hours delivery. So what is they doing what I cannot do? But in insurance, there is no race because there are already 20, 30, 40 insurance companies. What are they going to launch tomorrow? They all are, they are like elephants. Now, so what does GoDigit does? It goes and disrupts that communication. How does an insurance company communicates with the customers? How do they make the terms and conditions much easy for people who are laymen to understand? There are chatbots. People are building, I'm forgetting the name, a company is building bots. So look at typical housewife, with due respect, not very well educated. She wants to do transactions on mobile, but she does not know how to do it. So chatbot comes, it runs on your mobile, it talks to you in a native language and says, this is how you search, this is how you place an order, this is how you pay. So now that startup is solving a problem. He's converting a lot of people who can actually use, who can be a potential customer for a lot of B2C companies, but are not being able to purchase because of lack of how to purchase on a mobile, right? Solving that problem, and all of a sudden hits a big market. And then everybody from FMCG to household goods will go after that chatbot. I want that bot. I want a housewife to buy things worth from 100 rupees to 500 rupees once a week. We are good, right? So you first is about conviction. The conviction has to come from within. It comes either you face something in your life, right? If you don't, you hear about it, you know. So I can't give you an answer on that, right? It has to come. It is very, very personal. Just wanting an entrepreneur doesn't help. That's one. Second comes, okay, with the conviction, without the help of all the ecosystem we're talking about, what can I do? Where is my leverage point? What is it one thing, right? So we all talk about, there is this in Hindi, there is this, you know, we have those couplets where you have a sword and you have a needle. Now, big companies are like sword. You are like a needle. Where needle can do few things a sword cannot do. Now, what is that leverage point? That you have to figure out. What is that one thing which I will do within my constraint? When you champion that, and when you are convinced on it, then people take up notice. Then your investors take up notice. Then in your B2B space, the B2B veterans take notice. Okay, fine. So this is what you, drug discovery in pharma is a long process, very regulated. But if you're able to fasten that process, you're able to commercialize drug and you're able to monetize more, right? If you have a hack to reduce that process, you are onto something very big. But then you don't have the means. But once you're able to figure out your leverage, then I think the people, all the people in the ecosystem, they are there to help you. Now, then you say, okay, I want connect. I have something, but now I want connect. Now I want fund, right? They do it. The last point, please understand that everybody is a human being. Respect everyone, no doubt, but at the end of the day, they have their own emotions and challenges to deal with. So even the Fortune 500 CEO and the best of the investors will make mistakes. Some things they will get right, some things they will not get right. It will always happen. And there would always be a herd mentality. There's a herd mentality within youth, there's a herd mentality within students, don't mind. A lot of you will do what your peers are doing. What subjects do I choose? What electives do I choose? I'm sorry. Some of you will choose out of your love and conviction, some of you will choose, oh, my friend is choosing. It happens. It happens at the highest level. It happens even to even a prime minister or president. There is a herd mentality, right? So they would also not be completely objective. If you look, yes, there will be a slight ratio that people here from IIT, IIM, maybe they get preference. But as the friend rightly said, that is only an initial level. After you get in the battlefield and you're in the battle for a while, then all who are you, you know, which family you belong, which institute, all that doesn't matter. Then the one who's winning the battle, you know that matters, right? So I hope, I don't know if it gives you a good answer to what you asked. But in terms of, so all of these will help you, right? And there is something called fear of losing out, right? That really plays on a lot of people's mind, right? Fear of losing out. And let me also share one more point to what, it's a little contrary to, what my colleague mentioned here. I'm an entrepreneur. I've become a little successful. I may have spare capital. Yes, I can invest. Yes, I can be a mentor. But I have a very important question mark here. Maybe I should not invest. The moment you put an investment, you have an attraction. You want to see what is happening to my asset. The moment you see what is happening to my asset, you get involved. The moment you get involved, you get distracted. Warren Buffett says the people between extremely successful people and successful people is the people who say no to almost everything. So I'm perfectly all right if you're successful and you want to be an extremely selfish and say, oh no, I will not do anything and I will only do what I'm doing. I would respect you for that. Because that is the kind of focus you need to be able to build something meaningful, right? You need an extreme. You have to say no to almost everything, you know, to everybody. Only then do you get that small chance to be able to build something very, very meaningful, for yourself and, you know, for your country.
So I think Amarinder brought a very good perspective, a different perspective from the topic itself. So we were talking about unaccidental entrepreneurship, planned entrepreneurship. So Amarinder strongly supports, I think, accidental entrepreneurship or conviction-based entrepreneurship. In fact, I think even in a planned entrepreneurship, you will face so many challenges that you will keep changing course all the time. So as the proverb says, you know, all battles are planned, but no battle is actually fought according to plan, right? So just to now take this forward, we have been talking about all the good stories about the OLAs and the OUs and stuff. So what is the cost of failure is what we've not been discussing. So what about the people who try entrepreneurship, fail? What happens to them? Because we read only Times of India, which talks about the successful stories and millions of dollars that comes in funding or how people made successful exits. So Aakarsh, would you like to throw some light on that?
Okay, so to start with, you know, I follow the film industry very much, just like, you know, movies being a passion of mine, I follow it. So I'll take a parallel from that. Like, you know, there's a term called strugglers that are used for aspiring actors who are trying to make it big in the industry. A lot of them try, but, you know, only some of them end up becoming successful. So is the case of sports as well. Like, you know, take for instance, cricket. There are a lot of other people who are also trying, but, you know, somewhere fall by the wayside, which is fine. Attributing failure, there's this whole old school thought of, like, you know, you either win or you either learn. It is very cliched, but also true, because I think with failure comes like a lot more lessons than with success. Of course, both lessons are important. You also need to know why you're being successful. At the same time, you also need to know why you're failing. We've seen that many entrepreneurs have failed in their first instance, but that actually led to a very, very successful venture in the next innings. This is particularly evident at NSRCL, which is IIM Bangalore Startup Incubator. A lot of their first ventures when they were incubated there had failed, they had shut down. And you know, now they've become, like, you know, they've repurposed themselves and they've become different ventures. Nestaway, the founder Amarinder Singh, had done another venture while he was at IMB some 7, 8, 10 years ago, and it had failed then. Now it's become such a big phenomenon. I think the whole concept of failure is much like any other career, any other field. It's all about, like, you know, whether if it is something that you really want to prove a point, then, you know, you can be at it and be successful. There's nothing stopping you. Only the concept of failure in India and the Western world is very different. So if you're in the US and you say that you had 3 failed startups, you're likely to be respected or even get a very high paying job. But in India, failure is seen negatively. I've seen that startup founders who shut down their ventures, they went off LinkedIn and all other social media networks for a few years, and then they eventually resurfaced, because of the cost of failure is really high in India. It's just the perception. But however, that is changing. Now people are willing to accept failed entrepreneurs in ventures in a different capacity. So, you know, someone who may be good at tech, but the venture failed because the idea may have been bad or the timing and all of that. So they are being taken at really high packages, and they're happy to contribute and do a bigger contribution that way. It is a mix. It's a formula. It's a magic formula of founder into idea into timing. If all of this kind of works together is when, you know, the alchemy of success happens. But if even one part of the variable doesn't work, it may lead to failure, but it's okay. You have to get the equation right, and it works eventually. And that's what failure teaches you, how to get it right.
I just want to quickly add to it. I agree to what my friend said. However, failure is very much acceptable in India now. So my LinkedIn is full of entrepreneurs who did moderate success or reasonable success or couldn't do well, but they have gone and joined India's best startups at a very interesting, meaningful positions. I'm not going to talk about monetary, that, you know, and that should not be your driver, that if I fail, I'll get a high paying job or not. But I can tell you, as an employer, if I have a choice to hire a professional or if I have to hire an entrepreneur, in whichever capacity, he may be a founder, co-founder, he may be an early stage guy, but who has gone through the grind, I would any day take the entrepreneur. Why? First of all, because entrepreneurs have gone through the grind, and that is extremely valuable. Secondly, as an employer, you want to hire an employee to whom you want to tell as less as possible, because he'll figure it out himself. Right? He or she will do a good job himself. And that an entrepreneur is most likely to do than a professional, unless if we're talking of a very, very specialized technical field, which is very narrow or so. So so there are founders of good companies and early stage employees who haven't had a good kind of an exit or so, but they are working for a lot other good Indian startups, and they also get a lot of respect. In fact, there are startups now, when you look at their team photograph on social media, or when the founder talks to the press that, you know, how am I building my company, they say that out of my 150 employees or 120 employees, there are 40 or 50 who've been into some or the other kind of a venture, right? And that's the strength we bring in. And their customers also in B2B space tend to respect a lot that they have a very good, you know. And also your growth, you are able to, in a lesser number of years, you're able to go to a higher position or a more meaningful position, you know, you can do that. Yeah.
So hi. So I think one of the most important parts is when you don't succeed, there's a lot of lessons in humility that one learns. And not just about the startups, right? I think many of, you know, when you start working, you'll be given assignments. You may or may not do that assignment as well as you hope to have done it. You might be facing challenges and problems. But do not worry about that, right? But what matters in this journey was, were you humble enough to try your best? Were you smart enough to learn the tools to be successful? And also, can I just give one element of thought in this, right? It is not about just failure. Like, with whose money did you fail? Whose money did you fail with? Did you take a bank loan and didn't pay it? Then you're a criminal. If you have borrowed money from family, friends, and you know, you have some kind of paperwork and that money has been blown up, they're going to ask you for that money back. If you're not paid your vendors, you're a criminal. If you're not paid your employees, you're a criminal. Okay, let's be very blunt about this. So the cost of failure is not yours alone.
So is that the factor why people are scared of becoming entrepreneurs? That was exactly my next point. Sir, default on loans.
Money is important, sir.
Yeah.
Money is important. Okay, as much as the glamour that you talk about.
Yeah.
With all due respect, money does matter.
So
use money.
So if the guy is treated like a criminal, so obviously,
you are a criminal.
Yeah, so obviously students would not want to become entrepreneurs.
Your vendors are not going to just let you go, poor guy, yeah, you started up, it's okay, no problem, you know, chalta hai. They have families too.
So what is the protection? I mean, I take a loan from a bank and I'm an entrepreneur.
Take a loan, pay it back, you'll be respected.
Yeah, if I don't pay it back, what is the cost? That's what I'm saying. So it
then,
means,
sir, then we need to get a lawyer in the room to talk about what is the cost.
So it's better to be in the job, right, instead of becoming an entrepreneur.
No, there's no guarantee. Jobs are no longer guaranteed. So again, I'm trying to stress, you have to be good. You have to learn the tools. So even your point about, you know, people got hired because they failed. They got hired not because they failed or they were part of a startup. They have skill sets. Whoever hired them knew what they went through. They knew what is the hustle they put in, the growth tactics that they used, the fact that they could get sales, they could build technology, they have the humility. And they accepted it, yes, we didn't succeed, we are going to come to you. And a lot of companies do that. They hire people, even Amazon's, Google's, Microsoft of the world. All the most, 90% of the people who work on the startup ecosystem touch base are people who worked on in startups, who co-founded companies, didn't do too well, they shut down. But they don't have criminal cases against them. Because there is due diligence done, no? Please. There is, right, Aakarsh? They do due diligence. If you have something against you and you have done some, you know, gotala or whatever it is, you're not going to get hired.
Yeah.
Yeah, you will not get hired. So I think you should be very, very careful with whose money did you fail. Okay? So that, and just imagine, right, you were working somewhere, but you have cheated some customers. You were a salesperson or you were a marketing person or you're supposed to build a product. And then for whatever reasons, you will fail to deliver. Even a bigger company, you're going to get questioned. I mean, a very sobering thought. Very, very sobering thought. But remember, being humble and accepting that you have not done the job that you were supposed to do, but still trying your best to make up for it and say, okay, I messed up, but what can I still do for you to make things better? That's a skill set to have. Very critical skill set, right? The goodwill, relationship building is equally important. Whether you're working, you're a startup, you're a founder, or whatever it is. I mean, how would you feel that you started, you joined a startup but didn't get paid for 3 months? Startup guy, founder said like, hey man, sorry man, I failed, I messed up. I'm joining Google at, you know, 25 lakh CDC. You manage. Cheers, all the best. What do you think is going to happen? You think they're going to say, oh, good, no, nothing. Right? So we have to be very cautious about this, right? Because, I mean, look, I meet startups all the time. Right? And I meet people who are also working in large companies all the time who were startup founders. So let's be cautious about this, right? failure is not some badge of honor that you wear, because you just failed because you didn't put in a good effort, the whole world will know about it.
Yeah.
It's a perspective, but...
In fact, on one of our earlier shows, we had a very senior panelist who used the expression, the social cost of failure. And what he actually meant was when somebody sets out to be an entrepreneur, first of all, he looks for validation from his family and friends, which rarely comes, right? Until you prove something, I think everybody thinks that you are on the wrong track. Point number one. And point number two, God forbid, if something goes wrong, then the image that you lose is probably more expensive than the money that you lose. So,
if you have skill sets, you are wanted.
Right.
Simple as that. Build skill set, guys. Build skill set. That's it. That's all that matters.
So, for entrepreneurship to flourish, I think there needs to be some kind of intangible support coming through also from the ecosystem, right? For example, management institutes today welcome failed entrepreneurs. Some of them welcome failed entrepreneurs. So likewise, if corporates can encourage people who have failed on their projects to take back, get back to jobs, I think there are more chances that startups will flourish.
They're doing it. They welcome back them with open arms.
Right. I think that's the key to... increasing the number of successful startups.
I think Vijetha has actually opened up a deeper subject into failure, because even I go on various platforms, I do speak about failure at a macro level, but thanks for bringing it up at that real what failure means. So in that sense, it actually opened up my thought to three kinds of risks that you need to manage being an entrepreneur. One is like a financial risk, the other is an emotional risk, and the third one is a social risk. Financial, of course, you need to be responsible. That is like rule number one, because I think if you were an employee, a lot of other things are getting taken care of, but now you're responsible for 10 other people. Like, for instance, when I was in a job, I used to report to office by a certain time, by 9:30 or 10, and was the time, and I would come by 10, 10:15, but there would still be a lot of pressure and guilt for not coming in time. But now, after becoming an entrepreneur, that I thought I could be my boss and all, that's not the case. I have to show up earlier than my employees so that, I'm setting the example for the way the organization is run. So it's going to be a lot more responsibility, a lot more challenging, but it's always, trying to manage that risk, because, you need to project. So this is what I do, like, end of every year. I project the activity for the next year. And I see what is the financial damage that can happen if I don't have a single rupee of revenue, and then I plan accordingly. So I make my decisions accordingly. So it's really important, drawing on Vijetha's point, that how can you be responsible, how are you drawing that source of money, and how are you using it. Especially I've seen founders who get, after getting money, go into a very fancy office space and start investing in logo, in terms of branding and all of that. That's not necessarily adding to your bottom line or sales or the product. I think those are things that you need to fundamentally, it's common sense, like it's nothing more than that. It's just about managing that. And I think emotional risk is really high. I used to be a startup ecosystem enabler in the sense that I used to support startups and all. Then I was much more comfortable as a person, very nice and very giving. But after becoming an entrepreneur, I am very protective about my time. I have to I have to be very selfish for my venture, because there are other people getting affected by it. And also there's like this whole concept of mood swings. I thought that wouldn't exist, but it actually happened to me. Because I'm like going normally for 3-4 days, and suddenly I feel exhausted on the fifth day, and I feel like I need to take a break. Then I realized that, it's the ups and downs of the last 4-5 days that has hit me in one shot. And then, that is making me feel low all of a sudden. So these highs and lows are also something that you need to be aware of, understand your body, and then, be okay with it. Social, of course, is known about marriage, this, that, image, so on and so forth. So, sorry, I just distracted, but I wanted to share my experiences. Yeah.
They're all very relevant.
Changes. That's my only point.
Should we open up for Q&A? We would like to.
Yeah.
That was a very informative and interesting discussion. Thank you so much. Any questions from audience?
I have the first question.
Yeah.
So since sir told that, you know, entrepreneurship cannot be taught, but it can be learned. And since we're talking about unaccidental entrepreneurs, I think there could be a curriculum. According to your experience, what could be part of this curriculum which could be formed?
Yeah, so I'll answer that question because I'm actually building curriculum around that. Startupreneur, the venture that I'm running is actually in the space of working with incubators, educational institutions, accelerators, and giving them, enabling them with technology and various processes that will help them deliver a better experience. So in that sense, there is a curriculum that we've developed as part of our program. So the key elements of any entrepreneurship curriculum are that it has to be, theory has to be only like 20 or 30% of it, but 70, 80% has to be practical. And that is where what we have taken a fundamental step in our curriculum is you have to actually do the activity before, moving to the next level. So if for example, if it is about market research, you need to talk to 20 customers and then fill out the form, only then you go to the next level. As opposed to the earlier curriculum which spoke what market research is and left it at the will of the entrepreneur to, do it. If you're self-motivated, you'll go and do it. But otherwise, you need that kind of a structure which will actually help make you try out different things. So that's I think. But again, broadly, it all starts from idea and ends with a go-to-market strategy as to how you will engage with customers, how you'll get your first paying customers and all of that. So that's about it.
Okay. So I would like to add in curriculum in addition to what he mentioned about all these stages, you definitely want to understand about the legal, right? What is the legal entities, and there has been like even one people company, entities available. So one is the legal thing you need to understand, and as he rightly mentioned that you run a risk, right? Can we have some silence, please? Yeah, so one is the legal. Second is obviously we talk of marketing, and today, no matter what field you're in, digital marketing has become very, very important. So digital marketing would be another area of interest. Third would be, I really appreciate what you mentioned that it has to be a lot more practical than just doing a theory. So I think if you look at, and when you join an accelerator or, when you get investment and, they bring a whole ecosystem to you, so they get you legal support, they get you compliance support, they get you, I'm forgetting his name, but the investor in Big Basket, right? So they had invested in various B2C companies, so they try to centrally run their digital marketing and, Ganesh, yeah. So he has shared in some other forums that, we had few investments in a similar e-commerce model, and then, we had spent an X amount of money on digital marketing and offline, and we have had some learnings. So I think marketing is definitely very important. The one more thing which he also mentioned about him going to the office, right? So there is one myth which I would like to break is this, when you say that, I want to be an entrepreneur so that I can be free. It's actually both. I can be my own boss, I can do my own things. That is completely right and wrong. I mean, there is a context to it. So, see, being an entrepreneur is about telling yourself that I'll have to do things which I'm not comfortable doing, right? So you are a tech guy, you are a typical CTO, or a typical product guy, you don't want to talk to the customer. I'm sorry, you will have to. Fine, you may get a boredom CEO, you may get your first hire on business development, but you cannot shy by meeting a customer. So you have to also overcome a lot of aversions you have about yourself. There are a few things you don't want to do, and I'm sorry, but you'll have to do. And it doesn't stop, even if you're successful and you are rich and you have a big team. Again, the context will make you do things. This is one quality which I like about CEOs as compared to a lot other CXOs. If you ask a typical CEO to do meet someone at a extremely short notice, he or she is more open and comfortable because his life is more dynamic. There are times for a CEO, the business strategy, and he reads the newspaper next morning and it goes for a toss, what he had planned. He is much more used to being dynamic and dealing with uncertainty as compared to other CXOs. Other CXOs dwell up a bit of a comfort that I will prepare and go, right? So I think as a part of the curriculum, you should be, there should be an element of making them do things they should, you know, which they are not very comfortable doing, and overcoming that. That is a very, very important aspect, right? When we had an unfortunate incident in our country, the case and Ola and other people were called by the transport department, right? So there is this whole block, but Taxi for Sure founder is saying it seemed like we are back to students and standing in front of a principal. You know that, you know, what all rules are you following, what are you not following. So you didn't, so there are few things you don't plan, right? Country will come and change the regulation overnight and say, what are you doing? You can be behind bars, right? So you have to be prepared for it. You have to be willing to do an uncomfortable thing.
Sure. So I think the specific question was, what can the college do to foster entrepreneurship and, you know, make it part of the curriculum? So right now you have 7 days a week, you have 24/7, whatever you have that time. You have public holidays and all. So first question is, are they willing to spare Sundays and public holidays and early mornings and downtime? They do that, then you devise a curriculum for that. If they don't want to do that, don't bother. You're wasting your time. Okay, very, very blunt. Okay, because as they said, it's about getting your hands dirty. It's about getting your, you know, foot on the ground. And you have to observe small entrepreneurs first. Do not go and observe or shadow the large, successful entrepreneurs. There are so many micro entrepreneurs who work, you know, in smaller shops and retail and restaurants. These are also entrepreneurs, right? They get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, they work hard. If they don't earn money, there's a problem. So you have to understand the repercussions that if I don't earn, if I don't collect payment, there are certain things that will not go right in life. So unless you learn that lessons in humility, and in practical do-it-yourself kind of situation, it's very different. You know, you can't have a classroom curriculum for this. To some extent, you can. You can teach law, you can teach finance, you can teach term sheets, you can teach negotiation, you can teach HR, etc., etc. It's very important. The laws keep changing. But practical work is, can you sell? Can you build something from scratch and take it to the market? And will someone pay you the money? Or will someone promise to pay you the money and then disappear? Okay, so these are the, some of these practical things that, you know, I would love to help you guys also out, because if you do it only classroom, it will not work. It has to be, it has to put extra pressure on the students. Otherwise, it's just one more, you know, I'll just come few hours, I'll listen to some gyan and it will not work. Okay, that's all I want to say to that.
My name is Virender and I am pursuing second year BCom. So my question is to you three guys, like the main thing as a day-to-day entrepreneur, what is your main focus? As a day-to-day entrepreneur, what is your main focus?
Okay, so, shall I go? Okay. As an entrepreneur, your day-to-day focus is to move the needle. Today I am here. It has to be like a flowchart. What is the next most important thing I have to do? Just do that. So for example, you're in idea stage, you wanted to figure out, okay, I have to like do more homework research on the idea. Suppose you had an idea that, you know, let's take from a student life about, you can take any problem which is close to your heart you want to solve. So like, I have to understand a lot more about it. I have to read what is available, talk to a few people. So you do that. Then how do I solve? So you have to, but there'll be like many things, don't distract. Just pick up one thing which is the most important and say, okay, by next week or by 10 days or by 3 days, you know, I will just go and move it. The more narrow, more specific you will make, the more progress you'll be able to make in it. Generic answer.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely bang on point, like moving the needle. I think one place where you need to understand how your focus will be different from another person who could be an entrepreneur is where your strengths lie. So personally, I feel my strength as an entrepreneur is about building teams, is about maybe business development in the sense that building relationships. So I spend most of my time focusing on that, like, you know, hiring the right kind of people, you know, talking to the right partners, even in terms of envisioning the product and the way forward. This is what I do as a founder. Of course, you would have co-founders who have another area of specialization where they do really well. So it's really it's really important to understand what your strength is, focus your efforts on that, but also keep an eye out on the various other things, because now you're not running in isolation, because whatever you do here gets impacted in the overall big picture of the business. So you need to understand how, what you do, what move you make, how it impacts the broader business and the way it's functioning. So that's how it is. Yeah.
I think this is a lesson for everyone. Just please sit down, be comfortable. Yeah. So guys, when you're saying that as an entrepreneur, what are you supposed to focus on? So let me give you a scenario, right? Imagine that you are running a restaurant and your laser focus is at open the restaurant on time and the supplies has to come, correct? But just imagine that when you're trying to do all that, you don't have too much of staff, 5 customers walk in. So what is your focus? Yes, you have to serve, right? Then imagine that you also do takeaways. You have Swiggy and Zomato and the phone is ringing and you don't have enough staff. What's your focus? But now there are 2 customers. There are 5 people have walked in. Your phone is ringing. The suppliers are waiting at the back. They're waiting for payment. And I say, if you don't pay me, I will not give you the supplies. And you know that if I take advance business, I can get that money, I can pay the supplier. So what is your focus? So do you react? Do you plan? Do you have backup?
There is no time to plan also.
Yes. So what is your focus? So suddenly focus changes, right? Suddenly focus is no longer, it's on the situation. So being alert, being prepared, planning, knowing that if this happens, this is what I need to do. Do I have backup? I don't have backup. I think it's more important to focus on the dashboard. For those who are not paying attention also, I'm still saying this. The dashboard means you know the pulse of your business, right? You have total control and you know that, yes, you can't multitask. But if at this point of time in my business, in my day, in my week, I must make sure that I take care of this. For example, if you have professional services to file your tax returns on time, great. You have someone who can take care of your bank loans or investor relationship, great. But as a business owner, you have to focus on that. So during that time, this is the laser focus that you have to have. But when your business is running, when your operations are running, you have to focus on that. Now imagine that you are running a business which has got multiple time zones. So your customer is waking up in Dubai at, say, 10 o'clock in the morning, in Singapore at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, or whatever it is, right? So suddenly you have to have super focus 24/7, 7 days a week. Not easy life, no? So it's very difficult to say that, okay, this is my focus. I'm not contradicting what my esteemed colleagues have said, because what it means is, what is the most important thing for the business? You have to focus on that at that particular time. And you also have to pay attention to everything else is going on, because one small slip and the entire foundation can come crashing down. Okay? Make sense? Okay, that was a beautiful question. But how many businesses do you run? Have you ever done an internship? Have you ever done a part-time job? Have you ever sold anything? So that is for you. But what did you do? What was the impact that you were having? No impact, right? Think about that, okay? Chalo, cheers.
Good afternoon, sir. First of all, I'd like to thank you for sparing time and sharing your experiences. So I have 2 questions. My first question would be, what would be the basis of identifying a mentor? That would be my first question. And secondly, as we are living in a very competitive world, what would be the measures that I have to take to protect my idea so that it doesn't spread? So I'd like to know these 2 points.
Okay. Mentors, you want to
know? Yeah. Yeah, so there was a time when I thought, like, you know, I don't need mentors. That was a reality. Like, I used to feel like I know what to do, and I would listen to people, but I would do my own thing. Like you know, how parents are, and many elders around us, they tell something, but it actually means something valuable, but we don't understand it at that point. So first thing is, you need to yourself mature in terms of what exactly you need your mentoring for. For example, I realized that UI, UX, product, these are some areas where I thought I could do well, but getting a mentor perspective actually helped it take it to another level. Similarly, one of the mentors that we have for Startupreneurs sitting right here, Vijetha, is a good friend and a great mentor, because his skill set is in terms of business development, alliances, and how to move things forward in and international expansion and all of that. So I've been working with him, and he's, in fact, you know, the beauty of a mentor-mentee relationship is like sometimes the mentors push you more than you do yourself. So you tend to, you know, go back, and you also have that accountability to talk to that person, so there's some progress being made in the process. And it also, like, you know, a mentor is also someone who cares for your success. And is also becoming successful in the process, but is also cares for you more than you do for yourself. So that kind of relationship is really important. So you need to understand if you have the trust and understanding with that person. And secondly, what is specifically that input you can take away from that person? Of course, they may talk about different things, but there'll be those few nuggets which you have to take away and apply it in the context of your venture. That becomes really important. Yeah. So.
See, when it comes to mentor, for me, I think it is clarity of thought. So when I meet my boss, and I don't meet him very frequently, he's able to visualize the situation, see it in a completely different way, the way I see it. I'm pretty close, I'm emotional, I'm worked up, you know, I have my own reactions to the situation. And he's able to see it with complete calmness. And saying, okay, fine, this is what you said, this is what I understand, and this is your understanding of the landscape, but I see the landscape this way. So what you are complaining about or what you're not happy about is actually okay. What you're not seeing or what you're not thinking is actually worth doing. And this part even I don't know. A good mentor is someone who completely accepts that this part even I don't know. We have to together figure it out. We have to together work it out. And again, going back to what I said from first principles, let's. What is the assumption behind it? What is the model behind it? Why are we, if we are saying this can't be done, what is our benchmark? What is our reference point? Is it the industry standard? Is it our capability? Is the customer expectation fair, not fair? Is the industry mature, not mature? Do we have the right set of people? Are we expecting more out of people? So there, the mentor's more experience definitely helps, because most probably he's elder to you, he's seen more number of years, he's got some idea. But also the world is changing, right? So you have a lot of people with gray hair, but their workforce today is very young. And that today's workforce behavior is very different than the workforce they were used to. So now they need to also make a shift while advising you and managing their own business, that the dynamics have changed, right? So someone who sees things from a distance has an absolute clarity of thought and who's completely open to you saying that what I can help you, what I cannot. Because a mentor who's not genuine is a very dangerous situation, okay? And also a mentor is someone who also gives you space. He respects you that you heard him, but he would still want you to do what you think and what you believe, because you are man on the ground. If you do not do what he has said, next time he's willing to meet you with same openness, affection, and respect, and have a mature discussion about two people being equal and having it. Fine, I believe that you have. If you fail, he's not like, oh, no, I told you so. Not like that. Fine, you had your own conviction. As long as you learn from it and you say, fine, this thing I worked and this thing I... Also, the mentor is this, that sometimes you say that I actually, while you are saying this, but I am very much determined to do this. Fine, fine, he would say, fine, you do it then. He would also say, fine, if you're taking a contrary view than a mentor, he would still say, okay, what help you need, fine, we'll go this path. This path needs three things, two you do, one I will do for you, I'll do it. But you do it with full heart, do it with full force, and we'll again meet and see, you know, where we stand. That's the kind of a mentor I would want.
Fantastic. Thank you. So, you know, just to answer the thing about the mentor is, remember that a mentor will not do the work for you. Okay? They will not do the work for you. They will just guide you that, you know, you said that this is the pathway that I'm thinking of doing. Am I on the right path? Does this make sense? A good mentor will also challenge you that, have you thought of this, this, this? Have you thought of that if you do this, the what if scenario, the cause and effect? But the ownership is yours to be a worthy mentee. Okay? Because mentors, dime a dozen are there. The really good ones will never go and tell that I'm a mentor. Okay? They will look at you, how good you are. Are you really passionate about what you're doing? Do you really care? Are you going to make an impact? Then they will definitely support you. And your second question, if you can just quickly repeat it concisely.
That, so you how much do I share? What's my measure of my idea?
Okay, so why are you sharing it with anyone?
No, if I share my idea, suppose why, I want to talk,
let's start with the why.
Get the response.
No, guys, this is a master class I'm taking. So let's start with the why. Why are you sharing it with anyone else?
Just to know the impact about how the idea would work.
So you'll just catch someone random on the road and share it with them? No.
No.
Who will you share it with them?
With my friends, most probably.
Why?
Because I know they might
have an
idea.
You may be the biggest rogue. You'll take your idea and go away. Why are you sharing with them?
Okay, that makes
sense. Okay. So share it with the relevant people. Okay, number one. Number two, if you have an idea and you're confident about it.
Yeah.
Confident on what? That you can make money, it is worthwhile, it'll make an impact.
It can make an impact.
Yes, so why are you just sitting on your ass? Do something about it, right? Don't share it with anyone. Start working on it.
Okay.
Cool? Number one. Number two, are you doing this for social effect? In a sense that it's not about money, but you want to make an impact on people's lives?
No, sir, both.
You know.
It has to.
You want to make money, right?
So
that's why I say, okay, so you want to make money. So who's a customer? Number one, who's a customer? Who will pay for it, right? Also equally important in today's world, supposing you're building an app or something, you want people to test it, right? What they call as beta customer or early adopters, early users, you know, whatever, right? So you can start with that, okay? But if it's going to be a lot of hard work to build a product, no one is going to rob the idea from you. Okay, be very clear on this. If there is hard work involved, no one will touch your idea. But if it's something, you have an idea, you believe that it can create something where people are willing to pay for it, or it's going to make you famous, or it's going to make you win some prizes, or if it's going to create a situation where you show that you have done this and a large company is going to hire you, and they'll obviously look at the idea, they look at the technology, they look at the IP, if any, behind it, it doesn't matter. It seriously doesn't matter. Okay? So unless it's a really hardcore technology, where there has to be patents and IP and this and that, nothing else makes a difference, dude. Seriously. Okay? There is no protection of an idea. Because if you're capable saying that I have an idea, I know how to execute it, I don't need anyone else, then you're okay. But if you need to share it with someone who says, I have an idea, I need you to invest in it, then you need to share the plan with them. Otherwise, they will not give you money. Number one. You need three or four people either as co-founders or teammates or whatever it is to implement your idea. Right? Execute it. Because you don't have all the skills. You have to share the idea. Can it be? You can sign NDAs, right? There's some. You know what is NDAs, guys? Who knows what NDA stands for? Non-disclosure agreement, right? Not too very strong in India, again, very honestly. But you can get some paperwork done, right? You can do NDAs, you can do this, you can do that. If you feel they've taken this idea and are trying to do something, you can stop them or you can just kick them out of the team. Or don't share everything. Only share bits and pieces. For example, someone will help you to build it. Someone is going to help you to market it. Someone is going to help you to get partnerships and alliances so that money comes in. So there are different ways to do this. Make sense?
Makes sense.
Or you just said like, this guy, shut up and I'll sit down. Yeah?
No, sir.
I hope it makes sense, guys. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
They want me to shut up. Okay, good.
Can I just,
yeah, sure.
I just wanted to jump onto this topic because I actually did a video also on this whole concept of ideas and how, whether you need to share it or not. And I want to quote like three, four lines from that video itself. Like, I say in that, ideas are not original in the first place because they're just derived from various conversations, your interactions. So it's not something that originated in your head, but it comes through various aspects. So the second thing is ideas are not constant because most entrepreneurs will tell you that the first idea they started with is not the idea that they're doing currently. Take, for example, Amazon and Flipkart. They started selling books online, but today they're like a mega store or whatever. Even like, you know, Apple, for instance, started making computers and all of that, and then they now sell mobiles and whatnot. There is an evolution, and that comes with your learning. And the third aspect is ideas are plenty. What really matters is the execution. This is said enough and more times in the ecosystem. Everyone says this, and that is a fact. And now final line you need to remember is you cannot execute like somebody. Nobody can execute it like you. It is you what makes the idea unique. That's about it, yeah.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. I just wanted to touch bases when you mentioned about the late startups and early startups. I wanted to know why you prefer investing in late startups than the early ones. And the second part of the question is, what makes you think one is better than the other?
Okay, to me, right? The question was to me?
Oh, yeah. Okay. I like your opinion.
Okay, sure. So, first thing, I don't invest in startups. The second thing is, if I were to invest or if I were to put my bets, two things. I'm talking from an investor's perspective. Investors are putting money in late-stage ventures primarily because they have a proven business model. You know, they're already making some revenues and they need that capital, growth capital, to scale their business. So it is almost like this is a given, but you just need some extra money to kind of scale up. Hence, it is more secure investment. Hence, they invest in late stage ventures. Of course, early stage ventures, people, investors had put their money in like maybe 3 years ago in the ecosystem, but they're all, you know, they met with founders who are just like buying a car and, you know, investing in, you know, different things, getting a fancy office and all, and that fails because in the early stage, there's no clarity and there's no surety whether your business will do well. So people are not willing to put in money to validate your experiment. If it's already validated, we are going to put in money. So that is one of the reasons why you know, people prefer like a late stage investment over an early stage one. However, if you are really, really confident about the founder and everything, the returns are going to be manifold. Like Axel Partners, for instance, is an early stage VC. So they invest anywhere between, 3 to 15, 20 crores in a startup. And they've invested in some of the biggest startups, including Flipkart. So the upside is that, you know, when it goes to that kind of a valuation, you stand to make a lot of money. Like Inventors Capital invested in Redbus in a very early stage, and now they had a very good exit. So that is where you need to take a call. If you really believe in something, you can bet at early stage. But if you're looking for a quick return on investment, then go for a late stage. And final point, investors always look at the exit of their particular investment. So if they invested at a Series A stage, they would like to exit at a Series B or a Series C for a higher valuation. So if they invested 10 million, when it goes to a later stage, they may get 20 million out of that investment or 100 million or whatever. So that they're looking at the, you know, exit strategy for their particular investment. And there is a theme which is not politically correct, but is also there, which is called the greater fool theory. So what happens here is everybody is looking for the next person to, you know, sell it out and all of that. And finally, it comes to an IPO where, you know, investors are not able to put in money and then they go to the public for money. So it's all about, you know, how to pass the buck to the next level. That's about it, yeah.
Yeah, sir, my question to you, Vijetha, sir. Yeah, sir, you said financial resources are very critical for running a successful business venture, right, sir? You need to have financial resources. You said it, I quote what you said, your words, sir. Am I correct, sir?
Yes, you're correct.
Yeah, sir, being a student right now, we are in a phase of life, we are having a really limited financial resources. So how would we, how is that, like, what can we students at this part of our age, and how are we, like, going into this world, sir, being an entrepreneur, sir?
Okay.
What would you suggest going
for? I'll give you a master class. I'll tell you what to do. Right? Who are your 10 best friends? Catch them. Make them give you some money. Number one. Number two, get your parents, uncles, everyone to give you money. Okay? Number three, I'm sure your professors might want to invest in your company. So have you started a company yet?
No, sir. Not yet.
Start a company. First step. Well, who do you want them to give money to? You or to the company?
Sorry, sir.
You want money.
Yeah,
you want financial resources.
Yeah.
It's for you to have a good time or for a company?
It's for the company, sir.
So have you started a company?
No, sir. Not yet.
So when are you starting the company?
Sir, the chance.
When are you starting the company?
I am in my first year, sir.
Whenever you're ready, start the company, then you come to me. I will get you financial resources. Make 10 very good friends. You know, do research work. Make good friends with at least 10 people who come from rich families. Okay. Don't tell them now. Don't tell them. Guys, I'm very serious. I'm very, very serious. Please. The first money comes from family and friends. And your poor parents, but let's not drag them into this. Okay, or you find a rich uncle, a rich auntie, a rich grandfather. But it's not about you, right? You have to have a company. So what's the company all about?
Sir, the provided the chances of success, they're very minimal, sir.
Yeah, of course. You yourself have said you're not going to be successful.
Yeah.
And then you want to raise money.
Sir, but raising money comes with a, you have to pay them back, sir, right?
Oh, my God.
You talked about the points, sir.
Oh, my God. You have to pay them back. I didn't know this.
Yeah, sir, we do have to pay them back.
So you answered your own questions, right? You don't have a company. Do you have a company? No.
No.
Yes. You also realize you have to pay them back. So what is your plan to pay them back?
Sir, see.
What is your plan to pay them back?
So when the business.
What is your plan to pay them back?
Sir,
so have you made a plan to pay them back?
So when the business is successful, obviously I'm going to pay them back, sir, right?
Tell me now, how are you going to make the business successful? What's the business model?
Sir, my question is something different right now, sir. I'm telling you, being a student right now.
Yeah, agreed.
My financial resources are very limited.
Sir, yeah. I'm totally agreeing with you, sir. I'm giving you solutions also, how to solve your problem. Start a company.
Yeah.
All the best.
Hello. Okay, I have a I have a little different advice. You don't need to start a company. You can just do a pilot. Make the pilot successful. If the pilot is successful, it will be a little easy for you to ask money, and it will be easy to what would have excited us more is more about your idea. More and not about the constraint. See, you first see what is the idea you want to solve, and then we can figure out, okay, what is the funds it requires. A lot of things are doable in small amount of money. That's possible.
Sir, but that is my next question, sir. Considering India, so what do you think are the main, main things we can go for as students? What are the main entrepreneurial ideas you'll like to give?
That is exactly what I mentioned some time back, that it has to come out of conviction, out of your experience. If you want to go for idea shopping, then there can be lots of ideas, but they will not work. It has to come from your own need. For whatever number of years you're spending here, you can see what problems you face, and it has to come out from there. Ma'am told me that you have hostels and people come to the hostel, but after a year or so, they leave the hostel and they go out and they stay on a rented apartment. So what is happening here? Is it hostel is lacking something? Is it that in the rented apartment you get something extra which you don't get in the hostel? What is the phenomena happening here? I have a successful entrepreneur. Again, it's not a scalable story, but I'll tell you for the sake of it. So I have a Punjabi guy who came to our OCC meet and said, I came to Bangalore, I was 90 kgs, I joined my college, I became 50 kgs, and I was fed up with the food and I opened a restaurant. And today he has 4 restaurants. He solved the problem which he felt. He was not getting good food. He was feeling a lot of other people are not getting good food. He opened a restaurant. He worked very hard, and he opened a simple one for students without much capital and without making much fancy things. But slowly he worked. Now his parents were angry with him that what are you doing? Now they are running his restaurants. He has called them from Punjab that you come and stay in Bangalore and you manage one of them.
right? And I've been to his restaurant, right? So it's about, sir, if you want to have idea shopping and think of money, then see, that's what I'm saying. You're thinking very high. Think extremely immediate. Think how can exam preparation be solved? Think about how can student housing can be solved. Think of student problems which are very near to your life. How can they be solved, right? And that's the way to go about it.
Sir, you spoke about conviction a lot, sir. Can you please put it into some simple words so that we can understand
which
it
very deep?
Sir, conviction. You spoke about conviction, having conviction in yourself. So can you put it into some like simpler words?
Sure. No, that's a good question. Maybe we'll just part. What is it you're most passionate about?
Sorry, sir?
What is it that you're most passionate about?
Skiing, sir.
Sorry?
Skiing. Yeah.
No, that's fine. Skiing, right? Now, then there would be some things about skiing which you know, which others don't know. Now, you can you do skiing here in Bangalore? Why?
No, because there's no snow, sir.
So that's a problem to be solved. If you can figure out how many people in Bangalore would love to do skiing, they are fond of it. Now, what problems they have? They can't do all the year round, and they need to travel to a particular location in India or abroad to do it. And what is their spend? And if I can, at a fraction of that spend, on demand when they want to do, I can get them to skiing in India, in Bangalore, then I'm solving a very big problem. Then I'm solving a very interesting problem, right? I think you have a fantastic idea. But you obviously need space and snow and weather and all that, and this thing. But then you need to now meet
Sir, it all comes up to this thing, sir. Cost.
No, the people will fund it, right? The people who love skiing. Have you spoken to them?
Yeah, there are like, if I see, like, there will be many people who will be interested, but
so
the number.
That's what Elon Musk did for his latest model, right? He took pre-orders. But you got to go and meet them and talk to them.
So they have their own brand name already, sir. So we need to start from scratch.
How did you know that skiing is your passion?
Sorry, sir?
How did you know that skiing is your passion?
Sir, it's something like I've been doing from my very childhood.
Skiing is not a cheap sport, right? Like it's I'm assuming it's expensive. You have the money to ski, I'm assuming you have the money to start your venture also.
Sir,
that's the answer.
Sir, it's...
This insightful discussion in as short a manner as possible, and feel free to correct me if I am wrong. I would rather say what entrepreneurship is not, because it's more difficult to say what entrepreneurship is. One, it's not something that can be taught. It's an experiential journey. It's a drive to succeed at something that you are hungry to create. Point number one. Entrepreneurship is not an easy trade-off to a difficult job. And three, entrepreneurship is not for the faint-hearted. There will be highs and lows, there will be ups and downs. So we need to have the grit to tide through those turbulences. Elon Musk would say, if something is very important for you, you will get there no matter how difficult the situation is for you or how unfavorable the odds are for you. So great insights, awesome takeaways. Thank you so much for your valuable time.
Thank you. Thanks everyone.
Thank you so much. As a token of appreciation, I request Ms. Asha to hand over memento to the panelists. Yes, Mr. Aakarsh Naidu. Mr. Amarinder Singh. Mr. Vijetha Shastry. On behalf of Mr. Sid Baliga and Ms. Asha, the management of Dananda Sagar Business Academy, and fellow students. I thank the panelists for taking time off on the Saturday afternoon to discuss about the very interesting and important subject. The discussion was very relevant and very interesting for budding graduates. I also thank Ms. Asha and Mr. Seth for hosting this at our campus, thus immensely benefiting us. Thank you, one and all.